The actual division of British India between the two new dominions was accomplished according to what has come to be known as the 3rd of June Plan, or Mountbatten Plan. It was announced at a press conference by Lord Louis Mountbatten on the 3rd of June 1947, when the date of independence, 15th of August 1947, was also announced. The plan's main points were: Sikhs, Hindus and Muslims in Punjab and Bengal legislative assemblies would meet and vote for partition. If a simple majority of either group wanted partition, then these provinces would be divided. Sindh and Balochistan were to make their own decision. The fate of Northwest Frontier Province and Sylhet district of Assam was to be decided by a referendum. India would be independent by 15 August 1947. The separate independence of Bengal was ruled out. A boundary commission to be set up in case of partition. The Indian political leaders initially accepted the Mountbatten Plan on the 2nd of June. The plan could not deal with the question of the princely states, which were not British possessions, but on the 3rd of June Mountbatten advised them against remaining independent and urged them to join one of the two new dominions. The Muslim League's demands for a separate country were thus accepted. The INC's position on unity was also taken into account, while making Pakistan as small as possible. Mountbatten's formula was to divide India and at the same time retain maximum possible unity. Abul Kalam Azad expressed concern over the likelihood of violent riots, to which Mountbatten replied, "At least on this question I shall give you complete assurance. I shall see to it that there is no bloodshed and riot. I am a soldier and not a civilian. Once the partition is accepted in principle, I shall issue orders to see that there are no communal disturbances anywhere in the country. If there should be the slightest agitation, I shall adopt the sternest measures to nip the trouble in the bud." Jagmohan Malhotra, a former Indian civil servant, stated in 2005 that this comment by Mountbatten and what followed showed a glaring failure of the government machinery. On the 3rd of June 1947, the partition plan along religious lines was officially accepted by the INC Working Committee, but was strongly opposed by Gandhi. As a result, Gandhi was reportedly isolated by Jawaharlal Nehru and Patel and went on to observe Maun Vrat, or Day of Silence. Lord Mountbatten visited Gandhi and said he hoped that he would not oppose the partition, to which Gandhi wrote in reply, "Have I ever opposed you?" Muhammad Ali Jinnah, representing the Muslim League, B.R. Ambedkar, representing the Untouchable Community, and Tara Singh, representing the Sikhs, also agreed to a partition of the country along religious lines in stark opposition to Gandhi's views. Within British India, the border between India and Pakistan, the Radcliffe Line, was determined by a British government commissioned report prepared under the chairmanship of a London lawyer, Sir Cyril Radcliffe. Pakistan came into being with two separate enclaves, East Pakistan, which is today Bangladesh, and West Pakistan, separated geographically by India. India was formed out of the majority Hindu regions of British India and Pakistan from the majority Muslim areas. Radcliffe would later admit that he had erroneously relied on outdated maps and census materials in determining the Radcliffe line. On the 18th of July 1947, the British Parliament passed the Indian Independence Act that finalized the arrangements for partition and abandoned British control over the princely states, of which there were several hundred, leaving them free to choose whether to join one of the new dominions or to remain independent outside both. The Government of India Act of 1935 was adapted to provide a legal framework for the new dominions. The predominantly Hindu and Sikh areas were assigned to the new India and predominantly Muslim areas to the new nation of Pakistan. The plan included a partition of the Muslim majority provinces of Punjab and Bengal. The communal violence that accompanied the announcement of the Radcliffe Line was even more horrific than before. Describing the violence that accompanied the partition of India, Naseed Hajjari in Midnight's Furies wrote, "Gangs of killers set whole villages aflame, hacking to death men and children and the aged, while carrying off women to be raped. Some British soldiers and journalists who had witnessed the Nazi death camps claimed partition's brutalities were worse. Pregnant women had their breasts cut off, and babies hacked out of their bellies. Infants were found literally roasted on spits." Historians Ian Talbot and Gurupal Singh went even further, describing the violence associated with partition as having genocidal tendencies. They wrote, "There are numerous eyewitness accounts of the maiming and mutilation of victims. The catalogue of horrors includes the disemboweling of pregnant women, the slamming of babies' heads against brick walls, the cutting off of the victim's limbs and genitalia, and the displaying of heads and corpses. While previous communal riots had been deadly, the scale and level of brutality during the partition massacres was unprecedented. Although some scholars question the use of the term genocide concerning the partition massacres, much of the violence was manifested with genocidal tendencies. It was designed to cleanse an existing generation and prevent its future reproduction." On the 14th of August 1947, the new Dominion of Pakistan came into being, with Muhammad Ali Jinnah sworn in as its first Governor General in Karachi. The following day, 15 August 1947, India, now a smaller Dominion of India, became an independent country, with official ceremonies taking place in New Delhi, Jawaharlal Nehru assuming the office of Prime Minister, and with Viceroy Mountbatten staying on as the country's first Governor General. Gandhi remained in Bengal to work with the new refugees from the partition subcontinent. Following its creation as a new country, Pakistan applied for membership of the United Nations and was accepted by the General Assembly on the 30th of September 1947. The Dominion of India continued to have an existing seat as India had been a founding member of the United Nations since 1945. Massive population transfers occurred between the two newly formed states in the months immediately following the partition, with millions of people fleeing from what had once been their hometowns. Generally, it was thought that population transfers would be unnecessary because of the partitioning. Religious minorities were expected to stay put in the states they found themselves residing in. However, an exception was made for Punjab, where the transfer of populations was organized because of the communal violence affecting the province. This did not apply to other provinces. The population of undivided India in 1947 was about 390 million. After partition, there were 330 million people in India, 30 million in West Pakistan, and 30 million people in East Pakistan. Once the boundaries were established, about 14.5 million people crossed the borders to what they hoped was the relative safety of religious majority. The 1951 census of Pakistan identified the number of displaced persons in Pakistan at 7,226,600, presumably all Muslims who had entered Pakistan from India. The 1951 census of India counted 7,295,870 displaced persons, apparently all Hindus and Sikhs, who had moved to India from Pakistan immediately after the partition. Therefore, the overall total of displaced people is around 14.5 million. Although since both censuses were held about 4 years after the partition, this number includes net population increase following the mass migration. About 11.2 million, or 77.4% of the displaced persons, were in the West, the majority from the Punjab. 6.5 million Muslims moved from India to West Pakistan, and 4.7 million Hindus and Sikhs moved from West Pakistan to India. Thus, the net migration in the West from India to West Pakistan was 1.8 million. The other 3.3 million, or 22.6% of the displaced persons, were in the East. 2.6 million moved from East Pakistan to India, and 700,000 moved from India to East Pakistan. Thus, the net migration in the East was 1.9 million into India. The partition of British India split the former British province of Punjab between the Dominion of India and the Dominion of Pakistan. The mostly Muslim western part of the province became Pakistan's Punjab province. The mostly Hindu and Sikh eastern part became India's East Punjab state. Many Hindus and Sikhs lived in the west, and many Muslims lived in the east, and the fears of the minorities were so great that the partition saw many people here being displaced, and a lot of intercommunal violence taking place. Some have described the violence in Punjab as a retributive genocide. Around 6.5 million Muslims moved from East Punjab to West Punjab, and 4.7 million Hindus and Sikhs moved from West Punjab to East Punjab. The newly formed governments had not anticipated and were completely unequipped for a two-way migration of such magnitude. Violence and slaughter on an unprecedented scale broke out on both sides of the new India-Pakistan border. Estimates of the number of deaths vary, with low estimates at 200,000 and high estimates at 2 million. The worst case of violence among all regions is concluded to have taken place in Punjab. Virtually no Muslims survived in East Punjab, and virtually no Hindu or Sikh survived in West Punjab. Historian Lawrence James observed that Sir Francis Moody, the governor of West Punjab, estimated that 500,000 Muslims died trying to enter his province, while the British High Commission in Karachi put the full total at 800,000. This makes nonsense of the claim by Mountbatten and his partisans that only 200,000 were killed. During this period, many alleged that Tara Singh was endorsing the killing of Muslims. On the 3rd of March 1947 at Lahore, Singh, along with about 500 Sikhs, declared death to Pakistan. According to political scientist Ishtak Ahmed, on March 3, radical Sikh leader Master Tara Singh famously flashed his kirpan, or sword, outside the Punjab Assembly, calling for the destruction of the Pakistani idea, prompting violent response by the Muslims, mainly against Sikhs, but also Hindus, in the Muslim-majority districts of northern Punjab. Yet, at the end of that year, more Muslims had been killed in East Punjab than Hindus and Sikhs together in West Punjab. Nehru wrote to Gandhi on the 22nd of August that, up to that point, twice as many Muslims had been killed in East Punjab than Hindus and Sikhs in West Punjab. The province of Bengal was once again divided into the two separate entities of West Bengal, awarded to the Dominion of India, and East Bengal, awarded to the Dominion of Pakistan. East Bengal was renamed East Pakistan in 1955, and later became the independent nation of Bangladesh after the Bangladesh Liberation War of 1971. While the Muslim-majority districts of Murshidabad and Malda were given to India, the Hindu-majority district of Khulna and the Buddhist-majority of Chittagong Hill tracts were given to Pakistan, according to the Radcliffe Line. Thousands of Hindus located in the districts of East Bengal, which were awarded to Pakistan, found themselves being attacked, and this religious persecution forced hundreds of thousands of Hindus from East Bengal to seek refuge in India. The massive influx of Hindu refugees into Calcutta affected the demographics of the city. Many Muslims left the city for East Pakistan, and the refugee families occupied some of their homes and properties. At the time of partition, the majority of Sindh's prosperous upper and middle class were Hindu. The Hindus were mostly concentrated in cities and formed the majority of the population. Cities included Hyderabad, Karachi, Shikarpur, and Sukkur. During the initial months after partition, Only some Hindus migrated. However, by late 1947 and early 1948, the situation began to change. Large numbers of Muslim refugees from India started arriving in Sindh and began to live in crowded refugee camps. On the 6th of December 1947, communal violence broke out in Ajmer, India, precipitated by an argument between some Sindhi Hindu refugees and local Muslims in the Dargah Bazaar. Violence in Ajmer again broke out in the middle of December with stabbings, looting, and arson, resulting in mostly Muslim casualties. Many Muslims fled across the Thar Desert to Sindh in Pakistan. This sparked further anti-Hindu riots in Hyderabad, Sindh. On the 6th of January 1948, anti-Hindu riots broke out in Karachi, leading to an estimate of 1,100 casualties. The arrival of Sindhi Hindu refugees in North Gujarat's town of Godhra in March 1948 again sparked riots there, which led to more immigration of Muslims from Godhra to Pakistan. These events triggered the large-scale exodus of Hindus. An estimated 1.2 to 1.4 million Hindus migrated to India primarily by ship or train. Even though there was no mass violence in Gujarat as there was in Punjab and Bengal, Gujarat still experienced large refugee migrations. An estimated 340,000 Muslims migrated to Pakistan, of which 75% went to Karachi, largely due to business interests. The number of incoming refugees was quite large, with over a million people migrating to Gujarat. These Hindu refugees were largely Sindhi and Gujarati. For centuries, Delhi had been the capital of the Mughal Empire, from Babur to successors of Aurangzeb and previous Turkic Muslim rulers of North India. The series of Islamic rulers kept Delhi as a stronghold of their empires, leaving a vast array of Islamic architecture in Delhi, and a strong Islamic culture permeated the city. In 1911, when the British Raj shifted their colonial capital from Calcutta to Delhi, the nature of the city began changing. The core of the city was called Lutyens Delhi, named after the British architect Edwin Lutyens, and was designed to serve the needs of the small but growing British gentry. Nevertheless, in the 1941 census listed Delhi's population as being 33.2% Muslim. As refugees began pouring into Delhi in 1947, the city was ill-equipped to deal with the influx of residents. As thousands of Hindu and Sikh refugees from Punjab fled to the city, communal massacres rocked Muslim neighborhoods. A Pakistani diplomat in Delhi, Hussein, alleged that the Indian government was intent on eliminating Delhi's Muslim population or was indifferent to what happened to them. According to Hajjari, Hussein reported that army troops openly gunned down innocent Muslims. Indian Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru estimated 1,000 casualties in the city. However, other sources claimed that the casualty rate had been 20 times higher. Gyanendra Pandey's more recent account of the Delhi violence puts the figure of Muslim casualties in Delhi as being between 20,000 to 25,000. Tens of thousands of Muslims were driven to refugee camps regardless of their political affiliations, and numerous historical sites in Delhi such as the Purana Qila, Idgah, and Nizamuddin were transformed into refugee camps. In fact, many Hindu and Sikh refugees eventually occupied the abandoned houses of Delhi's Muslim inhabitants. At the culmination of the tensions in Delhi, 330,000 Muslims had migrated to Pakistan. The 1951 census registered a decrease in the Muslim population of the city from 33.2% in 1941 to only 5.3% in 1951. In several cases, rulers of princely states were involved in communal violence or did not do enough to stop in time. Some rulers were away from their states for the summer, such as those of the Sikh states. There were rumors that the rulers were whisked away by communal ministers in large part to avoid responsibility for the soon-to-come ethnic cleansing. However, in Bawalpur and Patiala, upon the return of their ruler to the state, there was a marked decrease in violence, and the rulers consequently stood against the cleansing. But Abita Hassan Sorwadi, the same who incited Muslims to attack Hindus during the Calcutta killings of August 1946, wrote to Gandhi, "What is the use now of the Maharaja of Patiala when all the Muslims have been eliminated, standing up as the champion of peace and order?" With the exceptions of Jind and Kapurthala, the violence was well organized in the Sikh states. In Patiala and Faridkot, the Maharajas responded to the call of Tara Singh to cleanse India of Muslims. The Maharaja of Patiala was offered the headship of a future united Sikh state that would rise from the ashes of a Punjab civil war. In Alwar and Bawalpur, communal sentiments extended to higher echelons of government, and the prime ministers of these states were said to have been involved in planning and directly overseeing the cleansing. In Bikaner, by contrast, the organization occurred at much lower levels. From September to November 1947, in the Jammu region of the princely state of Jammu and Kashmir, a large number of Muslims were massacred and others driven away to West Punjab. The impetus for this violence was partly due to the harrowing stories of Muslim atrocities brought by Hindu and Sikh refugees arriving to Jammu from West Punjab since March 1947. The killings were carried out by extremist Hindus and Sikhs, aided and abetted by the forces of the Dogra state, headed by the Maharaja of Jammu and Kashmir, Hari Singh. Observers state that Hari Singh aimed to alter the demographics of the region by eliminating the Muslim population and ensuring a Hindu majority. According to the 1951 census of India, 2% of India's population were refugees, 1.3% from West Pakistan and 0.7% from East Pakistan. Delhi received the largest number of refugees for a single city. The population of Delhi grew rapidly in 1947 from under 1 million to a little more than 2 million during the period 1941 to 1951. The refugees were housed in various historical and military locations such as the Purana Qila, Red Fort, and military barracks at Kingsway Camp. The latter became the site of one of the largest refugee camps in northern India, with more than 35,000 refugees at any given time, besides Kurukshetra camp near Panipat. The campsites were later converted into permanent housing through extensive building projects undertaken by the government of India from 1948 onwards. Many Sikhs and Hindu Punjabis came from West Punjab and settled in East Punjab and Delhi. Hindus fleeing from East Pakistan settled across eastern India and northeastern India, many ending up in neighboring Indian states such as West Bengal, Assam, and Tripura. Some migrants were sent to the Andaman Islands, where Bengalis today form the largest linguistic group. The 1951 census of Pakistan recorded that the most significant number of Muslim refugees came from the East Punjab and nearby Rajputana states, Alwar and Bharatpur. They were 5,783,100 and constituted 80.1% of Pakistan's total refugee population. This was the effect of the retributive ethnic cleansing on both sides of Punjab, where the Muslim population of East Punjab was forcibly expelled like the Hindu-Sikh population in West Punjab. Migration from other regions of India were as follows: Bihar, West Bengal, and Orissa, 700,300 or 9.8%. The United Provinces and Delhi, 464,200 or 6.4%. Gujarat and Bombay, 160,400 or 2.2%. Bhopal and Hyderabad, 95,200 or 1.2%. And Madras and Mysore, 18,000 or 0.2%. So far as the settlement in Pakistan was concerned, 97.4% of the refugees from East Punjab and its adjoining areas went to West Punjab, 95.9% from Bihar, West Bengal and Orissa went to East Pakistan, 95.5% from the United Provinces and Delhi went to West Pakistan, mainly in the Karachi division of Sindh, 97.2% from Bhopal and Hyderabad went to West Pakistan, mainly Karachi, and 98.9% from Bombay and Gujarat went to Pakistan, largely to Karachi, and 98.9% of the refugees from Madras and Mysore went to West Pakistan, mainly Karachi. West Punjab received the largest number of refugees, 73.1%, mainly from East Punjab and its adjoining areas. Sindh received the second largest number of refugees, 16.1% of the total migrants, while the Karachi division of Sindh received 8.5% of the total migrant population. East Bengal received the third largest number of refugees, 699,100, which constituted 9.7% of the total Muslim refugee population in Pakistan. 66.7% of the refugees in East Bengal originated from West Bengal, 14.5% from Bihar, and 11.8% from Assam. A study of the total population transfers in the districts of Punjab using the data provided by the 1931 and 1951 censuses has led to an estimate of 1.3 million missing Muslims who left Western India but did not reach Pakistan. The corresponding number of missing Hindus, Sikhs, along the western border is estimated to be approximately 800,000. This puts the total of missing people due to partition-related migration along the Punjab border to around 2.2 million people. Another study of the demographic consequences of partition in the Punjab region using the 1931, 1941 and 1951 censuses concluded that between 2.3 and 3.2 million people went missing in the Punjab. Both sides promised each other that they would try to restore women abducted and raped during the riots. The Indian government claimed that 33,000 Hindu and Sikh women were abducted, and the Pakistani government claimed that 50,000 Muslim women were abducted during the riots. By 1949, there were claims that 12,000 women had been recovered in India and 6,000 in Pakistan. By 1954, there were 20,728 Muslim women recovered from India and 9,032 Hindu and Sikh women recovered from Pakistan. Most of the Hindu and Sikh women refused to go back to India, fearing that their family would never accept them. This fear was mostly mirrored by Muslim women. Due to religious persecution in Pakistan, Hindus continue to flee to India. Most of them tend to settle in the state of Rajasthan in India. According to the Human Rights Commission of Pakistan data, just around 1,000 Hindu families fled to India in 2013. In May 2014, a member of the ruling Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz, Dr. Ramesh Kumar Vankwani, revealed in the National Assembly of Pakistan that around 5,000 Hindus are migrating from Pakistan to India every year. Since India is not a signatory to the 1951 United Nations Refugee Convention, it refuses to recognize Pakistani Hindu migrants as refugees. The population in the Thalpakar district in the Sindh province of West Pakistan was 80% Hindu and 20% Muslim at the time of independence in 1947. During the Indo-Pakistani wars of 1965 and 1971, the Hindu upper castes fled to India, which led to a massive demographic shift in the district. In 1978, India gave citizenship to 55,000 Pakistanis. By the time of the 1998 census of Pakistan, Muslims made up 64.4% of the population and Hindus 35.6% of the population in Thalpakar. The migration of Hindus from East Pakistan to India continued unabated after partition. The 1951 census in India recorded that 2.5 million refugees arrived from East Pakistan, of which 2.1 million migrated to West Bengal. These refugees arrived in waves and did not come solely at partition. By 1973, their number reached over 6 million. Even after the 1951 census, many Muslim families from India continued migrating to Pakistan throughout the 1950s and the early 1960s. According to historian Omar Khalidi, the Indian Muslim migration to Western Pakistan between December 1947 and December 1971 was from the United Provinces, Delhi, Gujarat, Rajasthan, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, and Kerala. The next stage of migration was between 1973 and the 1990s. In 1959, the International Labour Organization published a report stating that from 1951 to 1956, a total of 650,000 Muslims from India relocated to West Pakistan. However, Visaria raised doubts about the authenticity of the claims about Indian Muslim migration in Pakistan, since the 1961 census of Pakistan did not corroborate these figures. In the aftermath of the Indo-Pakistani War of 1965, 3,500 Muslim families migrated from the Indian part of the Thar Desert to the Pakistani section of the Thar Desert. The 1951 census in Pakistan recorded 671,000 refugees in East Pakistan, the majority of which came from West Bengal. The rest were from Bihar. According to the ILO, in the period 1951 to 1956, 500,000 Indian Muslims migrated to East Pakistan. By 1961, the numbers reached 850,000. In the aftermath of the riots in Ranchi and Jamshedpur, Biharis continued to migrate to East Pakistan well into the late 1960s and added up to around 1 million. Crude estimates suggest that about 1.5 million Muslims migrated from West Bengal and Bihar to East Bengal in the two decades after partition. The partition was a highly controversial arrangement and to this day remains a contentious point on the Indian subcontinent. According to American scholar Alan McGraw, in The Destruction of Pakistan's Democracy of 1996, many British leaders, including the British Viceroy Lord Mountbatten, were unhappy over the partition of India. Mountbatten had not only been accused of rushing the process, but also is alleged to have influenced the Radcliffe line in India's favour. The commission actually took longer to decide on a final boundary than on the partition itself. Thus, the two nations were granted their independence even before there was a defined boundary between them. Some critics alleged that this rush by the British led to increased cruelties during the partition. Because independence was declared prior to the actual partition, it was up to the new governments of India and Pakistan to keep public order. No large population movements were contemplated. The plan called for safeguards for minorities on both sides of the new border. It was a task at which both states failed. There was a complete breakdown of law and order. Many died in riots, massacres, or just from the hardships of their flight to safety. What ensued was one of the largest forced population movements in recorded history. According to scholar Richard Simmons, at the lowest estimate, 500,000 people died, and at least 12 million became homeless. However, many argue that the British were forced to rush the partition by events on the ground. Once in office, Mountbatten quickly became aware that if Britain were to avoid involvement in the civil war, which seemed increasingly likely, there was no alternative but to opt for partition and plan a hasty exit from India. Law and order had broken down many times before partition, with plenty of bloodshed on both sides. After the Second World War, Britain had limited resources and was unable to adequately keep order. It's argued that Mountbatten may have been too hasty, but he had no real options left and achieved the best he could under difficult circumstances. Lawrence James concurs that in 1947, Mountbatten was left with no option but to cut and run. The alternative seemed to be getting involved in a potentially bloody civil war from which it would be difficult to get out. Historian Venkat Dulpala rejects the idea that the British divide and rule policy was responsible for partition, and elaborates on the perspective that Pakistan was popularly imagined as a sovereign Islamic state, as a potential successor to the defunct Turkish Caliphate, and as a leader and protector of the entire Islamic world. Islamic scholars debated over creating Pakistan and its potential to become a true Islamic state. In their authoritative study of the partition, Talbot and Singh have shown that the partition was not the inevitable end of the so-called British divide and rule policy, nor was it the inevitable end of Hindu-Muslim differences. As late as 1940, partition might still have been avoided. Some earlier work, such as British historian Patrick French's Liberty or Death, shows how much came down to a clash of personalities among the politicians, particularly between Jinnah and Gandhi and Nehru. All three men were lawyers who received at least part of their education in England. They could have made potential close allies, but by the early 1940s, their relationship had grown so poisonous that they could barely sit in the same room. Ever since 1947, India and Pakistan nourished a deep-rooted mutual hostility. They have fought two inconclusive wars over the disputed region of Kashmir, the only Muslim-majority area to remain within India. In 1971, they fought over the secession of East Pakistan, which became Bangladesh. In 1999, after Pakistani troops crossed into an area of Kashmir called Kargil, the two countries came alarmingly close to a nuclear war. Despite periodic gestures towards peace negotiations and moments of reconciliation, the Indo-Pakistani conflict remains the dominant geopolitical reality of the region. In Kashmir, a prolonged insurgency against Indian rule has left thousands of people dead and still gives rise to intermittent violence. Meanwhile, in Pakistan, where half of the female population remains illiterate, defense takes up 20% of the budget, dwarfing the money available for health, education, infrastructure, and development. Pakistan feels insecure because India's population, its defense budget, and its economy are 7 times larger than Pakistan's. But the route that Pakistan has taken to defend itself against Indian demographic and military superiority has been disastrous for both countries. For more than 30 years, Pakistan's army and its secret service, the ISI, have relied on jihadi extremist groups to carry out their aims. These groups have been creating as much trouble for Pakistan as they have for India. Today, both India and Pakistan remain crippled by the narratives built around memories of the crimes of partition, as politicians, particularly in India, and the military, particularly in Pakistan, continue to stoke the hatreds of 1947 for their own ends. Hajjari points out that the rivalry between India and Pakistan is getting more rather than less dangerous. The two countries' nuclear arsenals are growing, militant groups are becoming more capable, and rapid media outlets on both sides are shrinking the scope for moderate voices. Moreover, Pakistan, nuclear-armed and deeply unstable, is not only a threat to India, it is now the world's problem, the epicenter of many of today's most alarming security risks. Indeed, it was out of the madrasas in Pakistan that the Taliban emerged, which would later take over Afghanistan. That regime provided sanctuary to Al-Qaeda's leadership before and after the 9/11 terrorist attacks. Hajjari concludes, "It is well past time that the heirs to Nehru and Jinnah finally put 1947's furies to rest. But the current picture is not encouraging. Both countries find themselves more vulnerable than ever to religious extremism. In a sense, the violence leading up to, during, and after the partition of 1947 has yet to come to an end. Thus, it is an old but lingering threat that has the potential today to put the region and even the entire world at risk.
Raghupati Raghav Raja Ram Patita Pavana Sita Ram Jay Raghupati Raghav Raja
Jai Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram.